I'm just letting y'all know right off the bat, y'all in for one today. Okay, we're gonna expand on making another Caucasian or making another white man influenced by Elijah Muhammad the Great, written by a Caucasian by the name of Paul Lawrence Guthrie. We're gonna expound on these teachings and go into the root of why the Caucasian was made, who made them, in other words, who set it in motion, who their God really is, who their father really is. You ever wonder, how could they force Christianity on the indigenous people? This is how you know they was bamboozled. Why would you be praying to the same God of your oppressors, and your oppressors are receiving much benefits? They're having that heaven while you're receiving hell. In other words, their God is your devil. When you use common sense, it makes sense. But we're going to go into the origin of the Caucasian. I mean, we're going past the Caucasus Mountains. We're going into what formed them up, even to the point of the first thought of even forming them up. Who brought up the thought of making this race? In the Bible, it says, let us make man. We're going to find out who that us is. Okay? Anyway, let's go. Now I'm going to take my time and break this shit down for y'all, because y'all got to see this just as clear as can be. Now, as we go into the Holy Tablets, a book that the FBI tried to ban, but they couldn't ban this knowledge. They tried. As y'all can see on Amazon, the book is $2,500. So this should tell you something. The book has up to like 1,700 pages in it of nothing but dynamic information. So we're going to talk about some shit that they tried to hide from us. But it's all good, because guess what? I got you. Now remember, the Bible said God came from T-Man, Habakkuk 3:3. They say he came from T-Man. Now T-Man is on the outskirts of Saudi Arabia, a Mecca. Back then they called it Becca back then though, but today it's called Mecca. So we're going to deal with this here God that came from T-Man. Now as we go into the Holy Tablets, I'll have to give y'all a brief analysis on what's happening to save some time, because this video will be entirely too long. So, what happens, so that y'all can get a full understanding of what's about to take place right here. So, you have this lady who did not want to marry somebody. She was forced to marry because back then they would set up marriages. They would be arranged. Okay? So, out of anger, the guy that she married, out of anger, and to get revenge on the man that she hated the man that she married. She ain't want nothing to do with him, period. So out of spite, she went and slept with his brother and had a child by his brother. And this is the beginning of Yaqub, the father of the Caucasian people. Now, as it reads, there was originally a village within which an illegitimate birth between Yitzchak and his brother Fakur's wife, Lucenas, occurred. Lucenas was mad at her father, Lamasa, for giving her away, but she always longed to marry a Turo, such as herself. So she, out of anger, had a child by Yitzchak, the disagreeable, yet reformed brother of Fakur. So her child would be of no service to her tribe. They gave birth to an unsightly being with the head of the size of two men by no fault of his own. As a child, he was the object of much attention because he had the head of the size of two men. The man, look, the boy had a water head, y'all. The boy had a water head. And when he grew up, many referred to him as the big head scientist, Yaqub, as he was called, wanted to get revenge on his people for their scorn and their mockery. See, they made fun of him, first of all, because his daddy brother got his mama pregnant. Okay? They called him a bastard child. Then they talked about his big ass head. So he was already born with a determined idea to cause chaos. Because even while he was in the womb of his mother, all that hate for his father. Okay, his not biological father, but his uncle, which was his mama's husband. All that brewed in the woman while the baby was in there, all that hate. And this boy came out with that already in him. He was groomed and formed in hate. So he was already born with a messed up, determined idea to cause chaos. This is the making of a devil. When you got hate brewing already in you, when you got that baby in you. Because when you got a baby in you, that child feels everything that that woman feels. And whatever that woman brings within her, that child is going to innately inherit it. Now, I want y'all to pay close attention. This is where things get real tricky at. This is the manipulation from higher conscious beings to low conscious beings. This is how a disagreeable gets one to do their bidding. Pay close attention. This was an opportune time for disagreeable Pleiadians from Pleiades, a star cluster in the Taurus constellation, to tap into his brains and inspire an unsightly thing. He was led to have faith that he could create a race of people that would rule over his own people and then the whole planet. The people around him got air of his diabolical plan, would ask him, will these people be wicked and warlike? He simply answered, only I know that answer, you do not. Now I want y'all to pay close attention to this shit and see how much aligned it is with the Holy Quran. Now when you go to chapter 230 of Surah, it's called Surah in the Quran. They don't say chapters, they say Surah. When you go to Surah 230, it says, just think, when your Lord said to the angels, lo, I am about to place a vicegerent on earth. They said, will you place on it one who will spread mischief and shed blood while we celebrate your holy and extol your holiness? He said, surely I know what you do not know. That's the same shit Yaqub said. Same shit he told his people. Again, it reads, the people around him that got air of his diabolical plan would ask him, will these people be wicked and warlike? He simply answered, only I know that answer, you do not. Same shit that the Quran talks about. Because he was a god. Just like the scriptures say, ye are God's children of the Most High God. So in the ancient world, back in them days, we were the gods because we had our original thought. Today, so-called black people do not have original thought because they have been colonized by a baby on the planet, a new race on the planet. Continuing on, he knew that he would be their god. He got his idea 8,400 years ago. The process would take 600 years, which would take him to the year 7,800. Yet the cursed seed of Canaan would manifest 6,600 years ago, according to their story or his story. This god, Yaqub, created his own Adam in his image, after his likeness, in the image of a human being, wicked and weak-minded, that was overcome with jealousies and envies. He was born with an inferiority complex and to subject the world to their wish of superiority. A new man, a kind of man, simply mankind. Thus you get a new people on the planet that is kind of like the original man. This is why the scripture said, let us make man in our own image. And of course that us is the pre-Adamites, the indigenous, bronze-skinned, copper-colored, so-called black people. Yaqub owed his particular appearance to the fact that he was mixed, for Taros were hydrocephalic, and Yitzchak was a Dunakio, who also had a large cranium. But his wife named Lunasus was herself disagreeable from the tribe of agreeable Taros, who had a dome-shaped skull. This combination produced the unsightly Yakub. The Taros lived in an adjacent cavern to the Donakios. The Taro Lucinus refused to stay amongst the Donakios, for she was always teased about her cone-shaped head. Thus, she came to the surface to seek out the surface Donakio. This surface-dwelling Donakio, who was brother of her husband, Yitzchok, was abstract-looking amongst surface dwellers, for his cranium was extremely large. This mixture gave birth to Yakub, yet they were the wisest of the wise in that land. They referred to them simply as the aliens because of their contact with the Pleiadians. Not only did her son have a head the size of two men, but two brains, both activated by visitors from Aldebaran, a double star in the Taurus constellation, and Pleiades, a cluster of stars in the Taurus constellation. His name was called Yakub, who was also known as Yahakabi, son of Yitzchok. He is also known as Yakub, as well as Yakub Har, Yakub El, or Bar Yitzchok. His mother's name was Lucinas, the terror of the original tribe of Lunarians, who came to this planet to dwell beneath the surface. The Lunarians occupied Kingu before the Hindu or the Maldekians came there. She was not in agreement with a Taro marrying a Donakio for political reasons. Rebelling, being weak and wicked, her trials and tribulations led to her desire to destroy men. Unknowing to her that this was prophesied by the wise 24 scientists called Magus, the Magi, who by the stars, who predicted his birth 15,000 years ago and charted this birth to be 8,400 years when he was actually born. He, they're talking about, is Yakub. So he was born in the house in the land of his uncle, Ammo, 20 miles outside of Mecca Arabia, and later to return there at age 5, with the determined idea to bring about a new people and to teach them to rule for 6,000 years. This creation would not be perfected, or completed until his people reached the place called Pelion, a peak 1,600.9 meters, 5,252 feet in height of northeast Greece and the mountain region of eastern Thessaly. Again, we are going into the hidden history of the Caucasians. You know why? Because we were never taught this in school. So we must understand why they have had a lust for blood, a lust to murder, a lust to pillage, a lust to steal land. They stole a whole country. Remember this shit. Now let us continue. His beast-like people took refuge in the caves of the mountains, ruled by an Enkiduet called Sirion, son of Cronus, and his wife, Philira. Y'all, this shit goes into the origin of the gods that we known about. Remember now, the Greeks were taught by Ethiopian people. So technically, the Greeks didn't have no culture. The Caucasian Greeks, because they were straight out the caves and shit, they had been grunting and walking on all fours. So the Greek language is technically an Ethiopian or African language. Now let's continue. Cronos was born a centaur. A senator, goddamn, because Cronos had his genes spliced with a horse. Cronos did this in order to deceive his original wife, Rhea, also called Rhea. Sirion and Artemis were educated by Apollo himself, and together they were the masters of medicine. Apollo was the son of Zeus and Leto.
call the deity of light, the sun, alchemy, and medicine, who coined the phrase, know thyself. That's been known all throughout Egypt. That was their phrase. Over every temple wall, it said, know thyself. Okay, continuing. A phrase used by his followers throughout time. This is their story as recorded by Mormon. Long ago, a spirit child was...
You know what? I'm about to skip this shit because they're taking a quick detour. They getting off subject for a brief moment. And guess what? I'm finna stick straight to Yaqub, the maker of the Caucasian race. Starting on 110 to pick up where we left off. He, Yaqub, that is, was raised to the height of prophethood because he claimed to have had visions. That instructed him to organize an assembly because all Zeosite creeds are an abomination and they discard the original rules and regulations and of their original purpose, which was the conquering and ruling over the planet and the spawning new families throughout. Greece became the home of these spirit children who had manifested in the flesh. Now, the part that I skipped was talking about children that was of jinn or children that was of demons. Y'all can go read it. Pause the shit if you want to. I left some of it there, but I'm trying to skip it to get to the point of Yaqub because I don't want to waste too much time. Now, continuing on. The seed of Yaqub. Wait a minute. Let me run it back. Greece became the home of these spirit children who had manifested in the flesh and were indeed goblins. Greece was their home base. The seed of Yaqub was to seek them out for unknown reasons. The hidden meaning was in the real name Patmos, the place of my own killing that is Patmos in the Aegean Sea. Ain't this some shit? The place of my own killing that is Patmos. See, this is why the Bible says he was a murderer from the beginning and a liar. And the truth is not in him. He was a murderer from the beginning. That is Greece, where this mad scientist Yaqub was to create a new race to destroy his own people in himself. Yet he died at the age of 150 and never saw the completion of his creation. They were all to be healthy, strong, and good breeders. This new god, Yaqub, made the flugeroids by genetic splicing called grafting. They were called Gruz or Jews, Caucasian Jews, to show forth his power and his wisdom, declaring himself the righteous. And he made a people genetically and mentally weak to give them the power to rule. Then he intended to eliminate them to show and prove that he is God, always was and will, and always will be. So his mother left Shambhala during the shadow hours. She surfaced and sought out the home of Fakir's brother, Yitzchak, who lived in Becca or Mecca. This was where the story of Plato of the seven men in the cave came from. These are the seven brothers, namely Fakir, Yitzchak, Amo, Hase, Rama, Akasad, and Tunde. Let me show, and you know what? We're going to skip that part and keep going so we can get straight to Yaqub.
Starting at 125, and Yitzchak was put to death for the very reasons, for that very reason. So let's keep going. For violating the sacred oath of Dunakal by marrying Fakir, his brother's wife. This further outraged the already deranged Yaqub. Man, this shit crazy. This here is the making of a psychopath. This man had to go through all this shit, Yaqub, as a child. Lusana's mother, Yaqub, was dissatisfied with the tranquility of Shambhala. Living under Dunakal rule and regulations, she found the home of Yitzchak, who took her in, and they birthed an illegitimate child, which is Yaqub. His mother, Lucinus, overcome by grief at the remembrance of her home, Shambhala, died an untimely death. And the following year, Yitzchak was killed, leaving the 5-year-old Yaqub parentless. Yaqub started school at the age of 4. By age six, Yaqub was living with his uncle Amo, the brother of his father, Yitzchak, who himself, many years before, was cast from Shamballa for disagreeable activity. Thus, he also took residence on the surface of the earth. Yaqub was living with Amo in his home 20 miles outside of Becca or Mecca. Remember, God came from T-Man. That's in Arabia. That's 20 miles outside of Arabia, as a matter of fact. He was fascinated by magnetism. This further affected the mental state of this now young man, living in the area where the original Garden of Eden was, yet 20 miles outside of the original site of the enclosed Garden of Delight, in a village in a mountain region called Arafat. The foundation of the Garden of Delight was built by Arazu and Ashnan, was responsible for the grain and the sustenance of the garden. And this enclosed Garden of Delight was to be the best part of the planet Earth. It was ruled by one of the 120 Akash Darfin, appointed by Koresh, who ruled from the seat of Medas in Chaldea, land of the demons. At the age of 18, Yaqub had already finished all of the schools of learning in his day and time. This is where Yaqub was to convert the people needed for the breeding of his new race. Ooh, shit. And the task of making a disagreeable, wicked, and physically weak being with the ability to rule with a special kind of reverse knowledge. Yaqub had a verbal fight with the Elohim of the holy city, who opposed him about deserting his people. Listen at this, y'all. And going off to make a new people that would be weak and wicked, that used their evil nature to try and conquer the righteous. They would be called the devil, and their lifespan to rule would be 6,000 years, which they would have lived as a new nation. Ooh, shit.
And this is the beginning of an horrific, bloody massacre. Then reverse lived, and you get devil. And live in reverse is evil. Why reverse? Because his nation was born with dyslexia, and they wrote from left to right, as opposed to the original right to left. Long before Yaqub was allowed to begin his undertaking, the word spread of his plan. One of the Elohim stepped forward of the righteous nation named Maluk, whose job was to try to convince him not to undertake this evil act, because he knew that it was going to be a horror movie in real life time. Now, I added that in now, but basically he knew this, okay, because they have the ability of what we call clairvoyance, where they can see into the future, see into the Akashic records and see what's going to happen. So they already knew what was going to happen. That's the way that the God worked. They write history in advance for 24,000 years. And they put it in book form and call it prophecy. And the way they do it is they do it through tapping into the Akashic records or the ethers. So this is, some of us get this premonition today and we call it deja vu. But deja vu is literally you just semi-tapped into your clairvoyant ability or tapped into the Akashic records. But these people could do it easily. It was common for them because they have the ability to use more than 8 to 10% of their brain capacity. And then their spiritual antenna is wide open. So this is what we call the Elohim or the Elohim. And the reason they write prophecy or future events 24,000 years in advance is to equal our home circumference, which is approximately like 24,000 miles in circumference. So they write history in accordance with the circumference of our planet Earth. Now, let me conclude. Now, we notice one thing, that one of the Elohim tried to stop him, or the Elohim. So the Elohim is like the angels or archangels. So that's where you get the word El. If you notice all the 24 elders in the scripture, every last one of the angels have an El at the end of their name. Whether it's Michael, Gabriel, Raphael, Manuel, whoever, all of them got an El at the end. Because they are the elders, or 24 elders. They are the gods that sit around the throne of him that gives the command, okay, which is the Most High God. Now, if you notice, this God, this Elohim or angel tried to stop him from his evil plan. Now it continues to read. It says, it resulted, right there where it say 149, it resulted in a physical fight against Yakub that lasted from 6 p.m. during the shadow hours straight on past 12:01 a.m. the next day. Thus, it is said that they fought up until the next day. Yakub had his right leg disjointed. See, this way in the Bible where it say, and Jacob, because the word Yakub in English is Jacob. It say Jacob wrestled with the angel till he had conquered the angel, and he forced the angel to bless him. That's what it's talking about. Now, listen at this. It said Jacob had his right leg disjointed. Yakub inquired of this Elohim, who was a mortal man in physical form at the end of the fight. What is your name? Only to be told, it is not written for you to know my name. See, some people say angels ain't humans. Yes, they are humans. They can be in a human form. Think about it, y'all. Remember, in the book of Genesis, it said three men came to Abraham. Two of them was angels. It say three men. It say two angels. Two of the men went into Sodom and Gomorrah. And one stayed with Abraham. And the one that stayed with Abraham was God in person. But the two that went into Sodom was two angels. And remember, they destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. So angels are humans, according to scripture. So anyway, he was wrestling with this angelic man. Now, he said, it's not written for you to know my name. This fight took place in Peniel, located on the north bank of Jabbok, close to the Jordan, for Yakub came face to face with an El. This is why the Bible said, and he came face to face with God, is where it talks about he saw God face to face, and he called him Peniel. But he was literally in a place called Peniel, according to the holy tablets. Now, continuing on, from that day on, Yakub was crippled, walking with a limp, carrying a cane. See, I didn't. Now, how we know this ain't where the pimp walk started at? How we know? I'm just saying, I know the shit a little far-fetched, but how we know this ain't where the pimp walk started at, where Yakub crazy ass, the psychopath Yakub. Okay? Now, check this. We're going to continue. This man opposed the fact that Yakub left the camp during the shadow hours, and he was trying to cross the lake of Jabbok, a stream which intersects the mountain range of Gilead and falls into the Jordan on the east about midway between the Sea of Galilee and the Dead Sea, with his assistance of doctors, nurses, and cremators, which by shadow hours they deserted all the rest of his family. And this Maluk declared that he would break both his legs before he let him pursue this undertaking in the making of this new breed of people. From his own genes being an original Negroid and brown mongoloid germ, the Negroid black germ, from his blood, the blood of the Nunakial, and the mongoloid brown germ, from his blood, the blood of the Taro, who had mixed with Pleiadians long ago. The conflict broke out and the fight ensued. So in other words, it's saying that the wrestling all night is in representation of Yakub separating the dark germ from the brown germ in order to make a lighter race of people. Now remember, the Holy Quran says, what will you make other than one that shall cause mischief and shed blood in the land. So the angels already knew prophecy. They already knew what he was finna do because they had foreseen it through the Akashic records that he was finna make a new people on the earth. Thus, let us make man in our image. Us, the original people, man is other races of people, Chinese, Japanese, and Caucasians. Everybody else, like Mexicans and Puerto Ricans, they are mixed breed between those races, which are the original or the original races that was made. But before they was all made, the entire planet was populated with so-called black people. Not no other races on this planet prior to 6,600 years ago. 6,800 years ago. No more than 7,000 years ago. And that's a fact. And when Yaqub's leg was dislocated, he held on to Maluk as the wicked troops of Shakur was coming over the horizon. Maluk said, "Let me go. And you have the blessings of the god of the Babylonian Ishtar, the god of the Egyptian Ra, and the god of the Sumerians El. You will have their blessings. Just don't pursue your undertaking." Again, he said, "Just don't pursue your undertaking. You shall be called Is, Ishtar Ra, Amun Ra, and El, Elum." That represented the three most powerful gods on the planet at the time. Isis, Ra, and El. Thus he became known as Israel. Touched by the hand of an Elohim or Elohim. You say Yisrael. So this is where the name Israel. Remember the Bible say Jacob's name was turned to his name was turned to Israel. Remember after he conquered the angel? So at that time, the Babylonian god was called Ishtar, the Egyptian god was called Ra, and the god of Sumeria was called El. Thus you get Israel. So it comes from these different gods during this time frame. And certain components of our planet are where people had their own god name. So I'm hoping this shit making sense to y'all because the puzzle pieces coming together so clearly. Now it goes on to read. Yaqub agreed, yet deceived him. See this shit? He was a murderer from the beginning and a liar. Remember the Bible say he was a liar and the truth abode not in him. Again, Yaqub agreed, yet deceived him, saying to all that he had got the blessings, which had given him consent to continue across the stream of Jabbok and to continue in his undertaking on his journey to Pelion. A Pelon, or I would say the Devil's Island. That's what it is, the damn Devil's Island. Because on that island was nothing but murder going on. Lying, deceitful shit, and pure mass murder. That's all it was. This Yaqub was killing so many people. This was a massacre chamber, a massacre island. This is why the scriptures say he was a murderer from the beginning. And a liar and a bold not in the truth. Nah, let's continue. It says that a peak on, just giving you the description of his island. A peak 1,601.9 meters, 5,252 feet high of northeast Greece and eastern Thessaly in the Isles of Patmos. An island of southeast Greece and the Dodecanese island in the Aegean Sea. Now, I'm going to tell you something. From here on out, I'm going to say Patmos, the devil's island, because that's where all the bloody massacre took place at. Where he was going to create his people and make them weak and wicked and give them the power to rule for 6,000 years. Yaqub was captured. As Yaqub made converts in and around the holy city of Becca or Mecca, persecution set in, and the authorities became afraid of such powerful teachings with promises of luxury and making slaves of others. As they began making arrests, those who believed the teachings the officers would go back and find, and to their surprise, others were still teaching and believing it. Finally, they arrested Yaqub. However, it only increased the teachings. They kept persecuting and arresting Yaqub's followers until they filled all the jails called and prisons or sajan beneath the desert sands. The 120 appointed Akashdarfin officers finally reported the new ruler named Koresh that there was no room for the prisoners, that they had no more room for Yaqub's converted followers, who were enraged for his abuse. They dragged Yaqub from his cell to the middle of the city. There they built a stone pillar in the center of the town and called it the seat of Satan, called it Al-Ula, where they tied Yaqub and asked the people of that city, should he be worshipped, praised, or stoned? They chose to stone him and call him Shaitan or Satan. See, look, they do the same shit over there in Arabia. The Muslims in Arabia, to this day, they take stones and throw it up against a pillar, and they claim that they're stoning Shaitan. And this is where it started at. Little do they even know. I guarantee you most of them don't even understand the ritual in which they are partaking in. This is the stoning of Yaqub. Yaqub's followers rioted in the prisons. All of the jails were filled, and they said, when we go back out into the streets, we found them still teaching. This is what was reported to King Koresh. What shall we do with them? The king questioned the officers on just what his teachings were. And of the name of the leader, they replied, Hagia. When the officers had given the king the answers to everything, the king said, this is not the name of that man. This man is Yaqub, the Negroid scientist, an alien to our land, a mischief maker in the land. This Shaitan was predicted by our Magus 15,000 years ago. On entering the prison, the king was shown Yaqub's cell. The walls were lined with sketches and plans of his future experiments. The ruler said, so you are Yaqub? He said, yes, I am. The king said, Yaqub, I have come to see if we could work out some agreement that would bring about an end to this trouble. What would you suggest? Yaqub told the king Koresh, if you give me and my followers everything to start a civilization as you have and furnish us with money and other necessities of life for 20 years, I will take my followers and we will go from you. The king was pleased with the suggestion and request made by Yaqub was sent to Mithriath, the money exchanger, and it was agreed to take care of them for 20 years until Yaqub's followers were able to go for themselves. After learning who Yaqub was, believing him to be Shaitan or Satan or the devil himself, they all were afraid of him, and they were glad to make almost any agreement with him and his followers. This is the history or future of Yaqub and his people, the Asiatic black men and women, black people with 6 ether straight hair of Hindu descent. Upon his release, y'all remember that now, his people with 6 ether straight hair of Hindu descent. Okay, that straight hair, they ain't had that woolly curly hair. They had the hair of the Lamb of God, as the Bible say he had woolly hair. Now listen now, upon his release, Yaqub was not allowed to preach. Yet his head prophet, called Hagia, prepared his followers. But for his master plan, he needed to convert loyal followers that would obey him regardless of who or what. This was executed by the loyal ones. Before this secret project could begin, there must be a great many people converted to his beliefs. He first traveled 20 miles inland from his uncle's house to the holy site where the tree of knowledge did sit. There he started to preach in the streets of Becca again, or Mecca that is, making such host of converts that the authorities increasingly concerned finally exiled him. They got tired of his ass. He and a small band of his followers, the doctors, the nurses, and the cremators, crossed northward up and over the Jordan and over to Egypt, which was originally called Ta, meaning land, and also Tamaria, meaning land of Ra, where they took ships into the Aegean Sea to await the arrival of his guinea pigs. Goddamn. He died of a brain tumor at the age of 150 before they arrived. But his scientists were prepared. The scientists of his wise man El Hakumat of his day said it couldn't be done. He departed, for they planned a plan to kill him and exile his followers. However, those who supported his undertakings prepared the greater fleet of ships to sail. Hagia, with 59,999 followers, sailed on a journey for a home in Ghana, there to stay for 50,000 years or until the new cycle. This journey took him and the Prophet Yaqub's followers completely around the continent, but not before there was a great falling away and dissatisfaction among his Yaqub's followers. In fact, about 9/10 of them were dissatisfied, for many did not want to leave their homeland. Great ships were prepared at the dock port in Sudan called Saudi, the outer field. The Asiatic black men who were followers of Yaqub and lived on the best part of the planet Earth were banished for following this alien and disregards of the laws of their own land. The time came for them to seek a new homeland of their own. Yaqub promised them a land flowing with milk and honey and streets paved in gold. Of course, he was a damn liar. He was a liar. Now, y'all remember, in one segment of this here session, in the past video, we talked about Akhenaten with his raggedy ass. Now you see, Akhenaten had one of the same game plans as Yaqub. Yaqub wanted to get back at his people by making a people that was to overthrow his people through bloodshed, through pillage, through lying and robbing. The same thing Akhenaten ass did when he went in the caves and got the cave dwellers, or the Caucasian people out of the caves, and tried to somewhat civilize them savages to overthrow Egypt. See what I'm talking about when I say Akhenaten was a baby Yaqub? He was a baby Yaqub. He was, but he ain't had shit on Yaqub. Yaqub was a straight psychopath. 199.99% psychopath. He was a mass murderer, and he was a stone-cold liar. Now let us keep it pushing. On this journey, as rumors spread from ship to ship that Yaqub's scientists were doing blood tests and experimenting and even throwing overboard those that... I don't want to miss shit. I got to say this over. Listen at this shit. On this journey, as rumors spread from ship to ship that Yaqub's scientists were doing blood tests and experimenting and even throwing overboard those they couldn't use or were panic-stricken, and they began to jump ship at several ports. This the same shit the goddamn cave dwellers, we gonna put it in modern term. This the same shit the Caucasians was doing on the transatlantic slave trade. If a slave got too sick, they couldn't use them, overboard they ass went, they let the sharks eat them. This is what they was doing. The same shit their father, Yaqub, was doing. Now check this out. Shasabarzer called Haggai himself jumped ship in Cape Town, being without guidance. So a lot of people was, they was stricken with panic. They was traumatized from seeing all this crazy shit go on the ships. Some of them was like, you know what? That's it. I quit. I can't do it. Y'all got it. Holler at you. Y'all go ahead. Peace. You know, may Yaqub, y'all God be with y'all. But I can't handle this shit. So it goes on, right? They wanted to go home and repent. The descendants of the dissatisfied had no remorse against their ancestors. The Chaldeans, Hindus, they just wanted to return to their homeland in Asia. Their leader, Zerubbabel, known as also as Shasabazar, which became the name of his lost tribe, and Haggai, thus having boarded the ships 600 heads per ship, making 100 ships. Unbeknown to them, it would take them around the whole continent of Ganawa. Odua, which is another name of Shasabazar, he led the tribe Shabazz on a pathless journey. The journey was to a place called Oya. The people there referred to his followers as Yoruba. They called him Obatala. His priesthood was called Orisha. Listen to this. Each was an Oba or a Papal. He was the first Pope. They sailed around the whole Ganawa. There were 59,999, and Shasabazar or Obadua, called Baba Shasabazar, made the 60,000 person. They had to make a 360 circle of Ganawa, leaving off the Suez Canal. They sailed in 100 boats with 600 people each. Shasabazar himself was on the first ship. Shasabazar jumped ship in Cape Town and never completed the journey. It was there that he died at the age of 120. See, you see how you got people abandoning this planned mission that Yaqub had, but he still had a lot of loyal people because obviously the shit was carried out. Okay, now it goes on. We're going to keep it pushing. He is known to have wandered throughout Ganawa as the wise old elder and sat in the circle of elders in Omduwanbin, where the eternal fire burns, there he was buried. Anyway, we're going to skip this part because they're going into a whole nother, they're going off scene right now. We're going to stay on scene. But basically what this is talking about, how they went from different parts of Africa, a few converts jumped on ships. The other ones that, you know, they was like, you know what, fuck this shit, y'all can have it. They jumped off ship. So it was picking up people, and also people were abandoning ship. So this is what it's talking about. But the majority of the people that he got, has all of them had straight hair. Okay? They had straight hair. Now, we're going to keep it pushing. And we're going to stay on course with Yaqub's grafted devil. So now that we know that he was going from port to port, gathering the people through converting them. Apparently the man was a powerful speaker, so we'll give him that credit. But we're going to pick up right here on 291, where it reads, so then they sailed north across the Mediterranean to Cyprus, where they were home with their original mother goddess Europa, stopping first at the Isles of Crete, where Yaqub's rules and regulations and system on grafting and making were prepared. Those that remained behind by jumping ships at different ports in Gondwana stayed and oppressed the original woolly-haired Anubians, introducing them to mythological religious beliefs such as New Yoruba, New Islam, Judaism, Christianity, and a host of others, which later became the enchantment or the spell. Goddamn. They also call the spell a hex. Hex like John, who's the he, and the X also called the hexagram, hexagram. The hexagram is the symbol of the six-pointed star, which again is the form of a swastika, the seal of the Illuminati of the light and fire, symbolizing their 6,000 years of rulership over the original Ishmaelites and Midianites. The word gram meaning a seed ties in, for this was the grafting of a zera, meaning an offspring or seed, symbolic of the sixth letter of the Aramaic alphabet and the sixth letter in the Arabic alphabet Seta, and the sixth letter in the Greek alphabet, which is Zeta, a symbol of a snake. The word Zeta is a Hebrew origin, meaning Zan, from the root word Zan, which is where they get Zina. Zina, which means abomination. Note the use of the letter Z repeatedly. Their symbol is hidden in zigzag zig, which is za za za, or 666. Zigzag zig is the German word zigzag, meaning to turn in the wrong direction. Ain't that some shit? The beings that inspired Yaqub, as well as the Yaqub of this day, Hitler, are from Zeta Reticula, also referred to as the Midzar constellation. Remember, seed is from Middle English, from Old English, seed, sed, from Latin, semen, from the Greek, sperma, meaning sperm or seed, or the number six in Greek, which is again hex, ze for xenon, the 54th element, and is colorless or the absence of melanin, from the Greek neter on xenos for strange. Neuter means neither feminine or the original hermaphrodites. And the parents of these Hindus whose religions was called Zen or Zen, from Zeno, meaning stranger. God damn, talk about going into the etymological root of words. My goodness. Okay, anyway, in the religion, Zen Buddhism is traced back to the Hindus in India. Now the hexagon, also called a polygon, with six sides, the number of the sum of these angles are 720 degrees. That would be 360 degrees of the spiritual and 360 degrees of the physical. When the sides are equal on all sides, the hexagon is called regular, and each interior angle is 120 degrees. The followers of Yaqub were only given 120 degrees of knowledge, not 360 and not 720. They only use 6 ounces of brain, and the Asiatic blacks use 7.5 ounces of brain. But you have 10 billion neurons in your brain weight, and your brain weight is 52 ounces. Their reticular formation, or the inner laser beam that directs the impulses to the two halves of the brain for actions and reactions, is defected. Even the slaves of the slave trade are led to have faith that they are of this lost tribe of Shabazz, and don the swastika in the form of an X, until they too can take on an Arabic name. Damn. Boy, y'all talk about this shit here. This shit is mind-blowing. How it is so precise and it is so detailed. You wonder why that damn book costs $2,500. Anyway, we're going to keep it pushing. From Alexandria, the journey continued on to their new home. These Asiatic black men with straight hair had a dissatisfied nature. Evil dwelled within them. So their wise scientists met with the elder of the Dunakiao, and they decided to try to graft the evil out of their nature. The results, the Flugoroids came out of this genetic splicing. And the graftation, an attempt to remove their disagreeable side, for evil lived within these Asiatic black men. Original Hindus, since their evil ancestors came to visit the planet between the time periods of 76 billion years to 66 billion years ago. Damn. Like, how the fuck? Like, who the fuck? Where the fuck? Who recorded this? Who documented this? How? Okay, maybe I'm missing something, y'all. Maybe I'm missing something, but, you know, we're going to keep it pushing. These Hindus are the ones who converted to Yaqub's plan. Y'all hear this? Do y'all hear this? Okay, look, check this out, right? Let's say if you take a Hindu, somebody from India with straight hair, and they have what we call today an albino. Do you know that that child or that person will look exactly like a Caucasian? Exactly. This is how you know. When the graftation took place, it came from these people. Okay, now stick with me now. We're going to keep it pushing. So now that we know that the Caucasian people were grafted from the original people of India, the melanated people of India with straight hair, now we understand why they have straight hair. Why, when you see an albino man from India, you will automatically think that it's a Caucasian. Anyway, let's keep it pushing. While living in Arabia, they became the tribe called Sheshbazar, the 13th tribe known as the Lost Tribe of Shabazz. For many of them got lost on the way. Those that survived the journey around Ganawa were used in the grafting and making of this new race. For any babies born with Negroid black genes, a pin was stuck in their brain. Damn. Then next was the Mongoloid brown. They were spared to breed to make the red, the yellow, and then the Caucasoid pinkish pale people. This process took 600 years of grafting and separating. So right here, y'all, we are witnessing a birth control human laboratory of a death devilish island. Because you got to think about all of the dark babies that were murdered with a needle stuck in their brain. See, what you got to understand is that when the baby first came out, and it's probably going to get there. When the baby first came out, if that baby was brown, real dark skin, a needle was stuck in his head instantly, and the parents were lied to, saying that the child was a stillborn. Yaqub taught them these rules and regulations, put it in book form, and the nurses, the cremators, and all of them followed it to the letter, even after he had passed away. So his will was done. This is why we got all these other races on our earth. Now let's keep going. Before we keep going, though, see, that was saving the lighter babies, killing off the darker babies. As a matter of fact, they didn't even have prisons. They didn't have jails. If you disobeyed the laws, they would feed you to the wild animals, the wild beasts of the field. But anyway, let's keep pushing. Thus, Yaqub's nation was born. A ruler was set over them, and she was called Europa, the daughter of Agenor and sister of Cadmus. Europa was empress of this land, yet without guidance, they regressed and took refuge in Pelion, a peak 1,601.9 meters, 5,252 feet high of northeast Greece and eastern Thessaly. That is the Isles of Patmos, or the Devil's Island, an island of northeast Greece and the Dodecanese Islands of the Aegean Sea. Then on up into the mountain region of Thessaly and into the Grotto or Grotti, meaning caves. God damn it. See what I'm saying? So they went from the island of Patmos, or the devil's laboratory, Yaku's devilish laboratory, of murdering all them innocent black babies, to going back to the paradise and then getting cast out, sent across the high Arabian Sea, and sent with their raggedy asses to the caves in the Caucasus Mountains. Okay, we're gonna keep it pushing. I know a lot of you motherfuckers hate this truth being revealed. Especially y'all nothing ass racist ass motherfucker that was in my comments on my Facebook page about a book I posted. Like, come on now. This is history here. This is highly educational. As a matter of fact, this is for educational purposes only. Because you're not going to be taught this in no college, no school, nowhere. They conquered and enslaved the original inhabitants of that land, then called Yunnan, who they were the descendants of Javan, the son of Japhet and Ephat. The Yunnan were also known as Ionans, the savage beasts that were grafted from the Asiatic Hindu black man, were nothing more than the original blonde-haired, blue-eyed, pale-skinned, melanin-lacking, grafted, disagreeable, rebellious seed of Yakub, the mad scientist, called Flugeroids, shameless, moralist, hair covering their body from ankle to shoulder, the beast of the field, also called Behemoth. They walked on all fours and ate flesh raw, having bestiality acts. Thus, the dog became their best friend. They allowed him to lick their leprous sores. The dog, that is, they allowed the dog to lick more than just that. Now, I'm just letting you know now, the dog was doing a whole lot of licking in them damn caves, y'all. Okay? This was bestiality. Anyway, they allowed the dog to lick them nasty sores, them leper sores, and to this day, they will allow them to sleep in their beds, eat off their plates, and even lick them in the mouth. I know this shit hurting y'all deep. I know it hurt. Look, y'all. This is just for educational purposes only. This is not to make nobody feel bad. Everybody's history somewhere along the way is ugly. Okay? But right now we're dealing with the hidden history of the Caucasian. Okay? So y'all just gonna have to take these blows and just roll with it. That's all I can tell you. Because you're gonna get this work. Regardless, okay? Anyway, let's keep it pushing. I mean, you know what? I done seen them plenty of times letting them dogs lick them in their mouth. Shit just disgusting to me. And that's them cave syndromes. That's that Neanderthal, Caucasus Mountain ass syndrome. Anyway, we're gonna keep it moving. But I know this shit telling the truth just based off what I see today. Okay, it says they moved on to Patmos in the Aegean Sea, which is 20 miles south of Samos. Okay, in the site of Samuel and 24 miles west of Asia Minor, that is the Greek Isles. The outcome of the graftation was the Flugeroids, who were bred by mixing with the seed of the Pleiadians, which is blonde hair, blue-eyed, mixing with the grafting of the genes of the Asiatic black straight-haired, black-skinned, and black-eyed Hindus grafting from the brown germ to the red germ to the yellow germ and on into the new earth breed, the Phlugeroids, a pale-skinned, pinkish Caucasian people. Also breeding the abstract black skin and blue-eyed, he set up rules and regulations that were to abide by under all circumstances. Those of his followers that did not obey him were to have their throats damn slit from ear to ear and their bodies left on the seashore at high tide. Damn. But see, when I say he was a murderer from the beginning and a liar, it's talking about Yaqub's and his followers, because they followed out his wicked ass mindset to the letter. The same way the Constitution has been interbred with nothing ass racist, raggedy ass, enslaving ass Caucasians. Their agenda is still being carried out through the Constitution because they interbred their mind in it, because it was written by them low vibrational parasites. So even though Yaqub didn't live to see the Caucasians being created, this is why the Bible say, no man has seen God and lived. They're a goddamn lie. What they talking about is the Caucasian hasn't seen their God and lived because he died at the age of 150. Okay? So they didn't see God and live because they weren't alive when he was in the process of getting ready to make them, because he died too soon. That's what it means. Because you got to think about it. Abraham saw his God. Moses saw his God. And remember the Bible say Moses spoke face to face with God as a man speaking to a friend. As a man speaking to his friend, y'all. That's what it say. He spoke with God face to face as a man speaking to his friend. So they lied talking about something. No man has seen God. But this, the truth is they didn't see their God. I just want to make that clear, y'all. Got to make that crystal clear. Now we're going to keep going on. Also breeding the abstract black skin and blue eyed. He set up rules and regulations that went to abide by under all circumstances. Those of his followers that did not. Oh, yeah, we read that already. Yeah, they ass got sent off. They got their throat slit from ear to ear. Now, they separated into two groups. The original Habilites or Halub Fluoride. Phlugeroids, who became known as the Neanderthals, or simply cavemen, eating raw flesh, running around on all fours, and living in a state of bestiality. They found their way into the inner caves of the planet. Many of them took residence there, while others in time used the technology and terrorized other innocent tribes. Those that did not jump ship were grafted out of existence. Oh, listen now. Those that did not jump ship were grafted out of existence, as opposed to the European Phlugeroid named Europeans after their female leader that rebelled, who is also named Europa, daughter of Enna, sister of Canmus, known as Zeus. The Europa gave birth to Zeus, another Z. That's the second Zig, the first being Zen, Zeus, who had three sons, Manos, Rhadamanthus, and Sarpedon. Now, I'm going to say something right quick. Now, if you say Jesus' name in Spanish, it's Jesus. Jesus means Hail Zeus. So the Christians all along have known this shit. Whether it be subconsciously, whether it be traditionally being passed down from the island of Patmos, from their father Yaqub, and transferred to the cave in the hillsides of the Caucasus Mountains, up until the point to where they started colonizing the indigenous people, setting villages on fire, colonizing, overthrowing the ancient Egyptians, the Kemites, and boom, today, after stealing an entire country, they have interbred that same shit, Jesus, a.k.a. this made-up Jesus character, into the minds of the indigenous people. So we clearly see it If you can see with a third eye vision, if you can see right through the bullshit and see it for what it is, you can see it. If your spiritual eyes open and you can mentally see it, it's for you. If you can't, stay in church. Yeah. Because this ain't for you. Because that church, I'm going to tell you now, that church is a box. You can't see past it. Can't see past it. You blind it. It's a veil. Anyway, we're going to keep it pushing.
She, Europa, eventually betrayed Zeus and remarried Asterius, ruler of Crete. At her death, she was defied as a fertility deity by Zeus. With this technology, they were given the power to rule for not less than 6,000 earth years. They entered from the east side, where there are harbors called Isthmus, into the Grotto or Grotti, which means a cavern. One of the entrances to the Phlugeroids cavern's home were called Palakwapi. Palakwapi. This is also where the scroll of Revelations was revealed to Yahuna Zebedee. That is John, son of Zebedee, the divine, in the year 96 AD. All of these are names used today. You may find them on your maps. For the original journey, the Asiatic blacks were divided into three classes for this journey. They lost 95% of their people. Damn, 95% of the people? 10% of the original 95% became betrayers, leaving 85% confused, and only 5% made it to the final destination. The journey was a 360-degree circle around the mother continent. Originally, they departed with 100 ships, which left carrying 59,999 passengers, and Sheshbazzar himself making it a total of 6,000 passengers. Yet only three ships arrived at the final destination, carrying 600 people on each. Damn, a total of 1,800 people arrived in Patmos, where the great scientists were going to spend 600 years trying to reform these disagreeable people by grafting the evil out of their genes. After futile attempts, they all agreed that it could not be done. For the making of this original seed, Yaqub El, called also Ella, Elo, as it says, came from T-Man. See, I said this shit. See, it said God came from T-Man in the Bible. Remember that shit? The South and the Holy One, Yitzchak, his father, was from Mount Paran, meaning place of caverns that led to Shambhala. Yaqub went to the worst part of the planet Earth, where his creation would live amongst the Nakahashites, where the original Shamael, the Luciferian, the evil reptilian, did dwell, in the abandoned place of Nod. All of them were dissatisfied. There were no one tribal people ruling the planet Earth in Yaqub's time. So this made it convenient. Y'all hear this shit? So Yaqub Her vowed to be their ruler and that he would create a people who would rule for 600 years until a savior was born. The Greeks and Roman Christians call him Messiah, Messias. The Khazar Jews call this savior Mishak. The Muslims call him Messiah. And the Nuwabic is Masu. Yaqub was helped by a group of humanoids from Lahamu, Venus. Their description is average height between 5'7", 6'3", with a tan complexion with black to dark brown, 6 ether hair. They could pass for any Euro-Arabs on Earth who had Maccabeans, who are humanoid Maccabeans
from Zeta Reticula. They have mixed with humans and have been here for many thousands of years, producing what is commonly known as little people, extremely short human beings who are neither pygmies nor midgets. Now, before y'all say, oh, that's just far-fetched. You mean tell me we got all these intermixing of different beings from the universe and the human on Earth? I can hear y'all now. I know how y'all think. I know how you niggas think. First and foremost, let me open up your little mind that's been enclosed in a little bitty microscopic box. The human being, especially the indigenous people, the aboriginals, they have what the scientists today call junk DNA. It's really not junk. It's really extraterrestrial DNA. It's just dormant. So we already have a galactic family of DNA within us from different planets, possibly dimensions too. Hell, who knows? The Lahamuians would use the marker beings as their servants. They have been visiting this planet for thousands of years. They refer to that planet as the early morning star. They vowed to send a Venerian as a savior to the new Asiatic black man. To him, he would appear in the person coming from Arabia. His mother will be called Mammy, who is of the Chaldean gods. They'll spell it Mammy, the Cushite, and his father, Alphonse, from the Greek Alpho, meaning anointed, or Alphas, or Alfonso, old Greek for leprosy, from the Alphos, meaning white, absence of pigment, albinism, a form of phosphorus. They'll spell his name Alfonso and declare he is a Cushite. He was one of the original incarnated deities, not men. This Venerian they will call their god incarnate. I'll be damned. He will leave them in agreeable humanoid Romdomanian as a teacher named Creel. Now, Creel is a title, but let's keep it pushing. They were talking about the making of a Jew, of the Jew, the original ones. Shasabazar means worshiper of fire. The color of their flag is the sun, with the moon and the star, which is a representation of the whole universe. This seed moved behind the Caucasus Mountains on up into Russia and became known as the Khazars. The woolly-haired seven-ether Orientalists of this seed called Asiatics were known as the Ashkenazims. These are the grafted devils that Yaqub created. They are your Flugelrod original Khazars and your Asiatic Ashkenazims. That symbol being the universe, the moon, called... You know what, y'all? I ain't gonna even read no more because we got to the heart of this thing. We didn't got to the root of why they was made. They was made by a rebellious child that had been traumatized even while in the womb of his own mother. He was traumatized. When he came out, he was traumatized. He was talked about by everybody. They talked about his big ass head. They talked about his mama. They were saying things like she was a slut because she had messed with her husband's son and got a baby bomb. So the boy was already traumatized because his real daddy was his uncle. And his mama's husband was actually his uncle. But this shit crazy, y'all. The boy was traumatized even while in the womb of his mama. Even in the womb. Because she hated the man that she had married. Okay, she hated the family that she was born into, the in-laws. She ain't even like them. So he was born already messed up. So now we can understand why the Caucasians was made. They were made for the purpose of destroying Yaqub's own race because he basically hated his own race. He wasn't shit. He was worse than Akhenaten. He was worse than Akhenaten. Yaqub wasn't shit. Remember, he's the father of the devil, he's the father of the Caucasians, according to the Bible. Okay? Remember, it says, ye are of your father, the devil. He was a murderer from the beginning and a liar, and abode not in the truth, because the truth is not in him. When he speaketh of his own. That's where they say, somewhere along them lines. I might not be right on it, but goddammit, I'm close. See, he wasn't shit. I can't emphasize that enough. He created a race of people to destroy his own people, and they have done it. They went around the whole planet just destroying, pillaging, taking ass, everything, taking advantage of children, men, women, everything. His job was done. Now, we're going to read a little bit right here, because I think this right here is well to know. See, right here on 14, it was predicted of him by the Magus 15,000 years ago that he will make a devil. He also named the first male of his creation Adam, and his wife was Lilith. So he was born with a determined idea to make a people to rule for 6,000 years. Okay, now look, it was prophesied also that after 6,000 years that one will come and destroy the Caucasian race. Totally, because technically, according to what I've read and what Elijah Muhammad, the great, said, basically he said that the Caucasian was an experiment race to try to overthrow the original people. But it is said that in the 7,000 year, one from the east will come to the west and destroy the ruling powers and put the original people back on their feet of power and rule of civilization. This is the prophecy that has been laid out, that has been written. Even the FBI know about this shit. They already know about it. That's why they've been trying to stop the rise of a black messiah. That's J. Edgar Hoover. If you know about COINTELPRO, you're talking about, he had an agenda to stop the rise of a black messiah, because he already know prophecy. They know prophecy. They know that one will rise up amongst the original people in America and will be taught by the great Mahdi, as the Muslim world or the Islamic world call him. They call him Mahdi, but over in the Western Hemisphere, they call him the Messiah. But he will raise up one amongst the people that speaks their own language. So they can't have an excuse saying they didn't understand the language if he come over here speaking another language. Because he's supposed to be coming from the East, the one that's supposed to be destroying the Caucasian race. Scored on the prophecy now. Anyway, this has been a thorough breakdown of the making of the Caucasian, or the making of the white man, influenced by Elijah Muhammad, the great, the one they hate the most. I hope y'all learned something from this video. I hope that the pieces have been puzzled together so that you could understand the making of a lustful, bloodthirsty, barbaric, savage, historically documented race that history is nothing to glorify. It's written in bloodshed. It's a horror movie in real life. But until then, may the force be with you all. Peace.